Thank you, Mark, and good morning. We are back in the book of Romans. We're looking at chapter 16 and verses 17 through 20. Now I urge you, brethren, keep your eye on those who cause dissensions and hindrances contrary to the teaching which you learned, and turn away from them. For such men are slaves, not of our Lord Christ, but of their own appetites. And by their smooth and flattering speech, they deceive the hearts of the unsuspecting. For the report of your obedience has reached to all. Therefore, I am rejoicing over you. But I want you to be wise in what is good and innocent in what is evil. The God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. May the Lord bless this reading of his word. It's the year 2017, which marks the 500th anniversary of the Reformation. A mighty fortress is our God is the anthem of the Reformation. We sing, the Prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can't endure, for lo, his doom is sure. It's a bold declaration of what Paul says, that the God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. That's true. We're promised victory. We have hope. But in the meantime, we have work. We have battles to fight. And the enemy is strong. Luther called him the Prince of Darkness Grim, but he appears as an angel of light. So we must be wise and ready. That is Paul's counsel to the Romans here in the last chapter of the book, Romans 16, verses 17 through 20. Paul was finishing the letter. He had given greetings to his friends when he interrupted himself to give a last warning. There were enemies, not only in the world, but in the church. Be alert. That's how he begins. Now, I urge you, brethren, keep your eye on those who cause dissensions and hindrances contrary to the teaching which you learned, and turn away from them. The people they were to be watching were troublemakers. They caused divisions in the body. They caused hindrances, which means stumbling blocks, literally scandals. And Paul was very concerned to keep the church free of those and united. He has given a lot of instruction on that in chapters 14 and 15. Unity was essential to Paul. Sometimes, of course, divisions are necessary when the truth is at stake. The gospel itself is a stumbling block to unbelievers. We can never compromise the gospel for the sake of unity. So loyalty to Christ causes divisions and will cut us off from people, cut us off from the world in many ways. But those who are loyal to Christ must always be watchful for those who would disturb real unity and divide a church. Discord, division is a work of Satan. God is a God of peace, not a God of confusion, Paul told the Corinthians. And so the clear signs that the devil is at work and not God are disputes and dissensions. We have a good illustration of the problem from Israel's history. Almost from the time the people left Egypt, they were grumbling. They doubted God. They threatened Moses. The critical moment came when the 12 spies returned from scouting the land of Canaan. They were divided over Israel's ability to conquer it. 10 said no, 2 said yes. Unbelief won. The 10 spies produced dissension in the nation and rebellion that led to judgment and 40 years of wandering in the wilderness. To protect the church from that, Paul told them to keep an eye on those who cause dissensions, to prevent them from having an influence. Dissensions are deadly to a church. Now, sometimes Christians can be the source of the problem. They can be troublemakers due to immaturity and pride. They can grumble. We all have to personally guard against that. But Paul is speaking of something different here. He's referring to unbelievers. He's referring to people who come into congregations and begin to have an evil influence. And there are people like that who move from congregation to congregation. The hindrance or stumbling block they cause is the result of error they hold, a false teaching that they hold. Paul says they do what is contrary to the teaching of the apostles. All the churches had a standard of truth and conduct. It's preserved for us in the New Testament. And by it, Christians can evaluate the genuineness of a person's ministry. So, for example, Paul began the letter with the first four verses describing Christ as the Son of God and the Son of David. That's how this book of Romans begins. He begins with Christ being both God and man, his origin in heaven, his origin on earth. He has stated that he has been declared the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead. So the deity of Christ, the humanity of Christ, the resurrection of Christ, all of that is stated at the very beginning. It's a standard of genuine faith. If a person preaches Christ different from that, a different Christ, then his preaching is not true. And in the first centuries of the church, there was a lot of false teaching. The Ebionites were some of the original heretics who affirmed themselves as Christians and believers in Christ, but they denied the deity of Christ. And then in the second and third centuries, there were the Gnostics who denied the true humanity of Christ. And then in the fourth century, there were the Arians who recognized Christ's humanity and affirmed that he was more than a man. He was a heavenly being, but still he was less than God. Those were early heresies, but they're all with us today. Some of this is in the theology of liberalism. Some of it is in the ideas of the cults. But they all deny that Christ is very God of very God. Others may accept the deity and the humanity of Christ. They may be orthodox in that regard, but they deny the sufficiency of his sacrifice for sin and teach that we must add some work of our own, the sacraments of baptism or the Mass. All of that is contrary to the gospel that Paul preached, which was salvation by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, who is the God-man. But there are many forms of error. From the description Paul gives in verse 18, the false teaching he warned about seems to have been a form of antinomianism, meaning it is against moral law. Belief, meaning it is against moral law. Beliefs that encouraged or permitted immorality. For such men, he says, are slaves, not of our Lord Christ, but of their own appetites. Literally, he said, they are slaves of their own belly. That's a graphic description of self-indulgence. These guys are not uncommon. They prey on others. They live for food, for money, for pleasure, for ego, for self-gratification. Their lives and motives are governed by their appetites. Someone once described these false teachers as blind mouths. They don't see the truth. They don't understand the truth. They live for their mouth, to fill their mouth, to feed themselves. And so They don't subject themselves to God's law. They live as a law unto themselves, doing whatever will gratify self, whether it be satisfying their pride or their belly. This is the motive for their so-called ministry. It has nothing to do with serving Christ. Paul says they are not slaves of Christ, but slaves of their stomachs. Their motive is filling self. Their method is given in the rest of the verse. By their smooth and flattering speech, they deceive the hearts of the unsuspecting. That word unsuspecting is not given as an excuse for these individuals. It's really a criticism. They should not be unsuspecting, but because they are unsuspecting, they're prey, the prey of these people. These people are smooth. They are disarming. They don't rouse suspicion. When I was a schoolboy in my early teens, we read poetry in English class. I was not all that familiar with poetry at the time. And the one poem in particular that I remember reading then was one by Carl Sandburg called Fog. And it begins, "The fog comes on little cat feet." And I remember that line because I was at the time unfamiliar with metaphor, and I was maybe a little too literalistic and puzzled by that. Fog with feet, and why cat feet? And so the teacher explained it to us. I wasn't the only one that was puzzled over it, and she explained that cats walk quietly. And at the time we had a cat, and I could see that. Yeah, they do. They walk quietly, and fog comes quietly, unnoticed. Well, so do false brethren. They don't enter the church with a bang. They come softly on little cat feet. They come as eager believers. They come as people who want to contribute to the ministry. They creep in like fog and cause a fog. They blind the unsuspecting to the truth. Their method is an old method. It was tried and proved by their master long ago in the garden. We learn a lot about the wiles of the devil from his conversation with Eve in Genesis 3. Satan entered the garden and approached the woman as a concerned friend and began to talk to her about God. And the one rule, the one prohibition that he gave her, gave to them, don't eat of the one tree. Now, the serpent didn't come in as the adversary that he was. As my Hebrew professor, Dr. Walke, put it, he came to her in the guise of a winsome, angelic theologian. He came to Eve as a friend and as one with true knowledge. He knew the truth. He had the inside understanding of things. And the first thing Satan did was cast doubt on God's goodness by questioning God's word. Indeed, has God said, in other words, has God really said, you shall not eat from any tree of the garden? Well, the answer to that is no. Just the opposite. You can eat of any tree of the garden, just not that one. But he twisted it and distorted it to sow seeds of doubt within her heart, and she didn't respond to that. She was unsuspecting. And then, having done that, he blatantly contradicted God's statement, "You surely will not die." What he's saying is, God has lied to you. Don't believe his word. God doesn't want you to be like him. He doesn't want your eyes open so that you know good and evil. He wants to hold you back. He wants to suppress your happiness. Eve believed him. She was deceived. She ate. She gave the fruit to Adam. He ate. And they both died spiritually immediately, and then later physically, 900 years later. But they died, and they brought death and sorrow on all mankind. Oh, the the horrible things people fall into for the sake of self-fulfillment, for the sake of pleasure. It seems so right at the time. It seems so exciting. That's how temptation occurs. We first doubt God's goodness, then we disbelieve His word. And finally, we rebel, thinking that disobedience is the way to reach our full potential or real happiness. Error enters the church in much the same way that it entered the garden, with the same result. Men with a false gospel came in disguise. They came as wolves in sheep's clothing. They may be charming, winsome people, attractive in many ways. They speak of compassion. They speak of tolerance and social justice. Maybe they know the Bible and they quote it effectively. They may preach their theology with conviction. They may be erudite, articulate, and persuasive. They will be. If they're effective, they will be. But it's a different theology. They preach a different God. Not the God of holiness, wrath, and blood atonement. And they're persuasive to the unsuspecting. The result is people who receive that teaching feel free to do what is right in their own eyes, to be a law unto themselves, to seek their happiness by gratifying self first. That's lawlessness. It leads to immorality and death. That's what Paul was warning against. The right response to this is given in verse 17. Turn away from them. He didn't say debate them. Now that may be necessary on occasion, but what Paul is saying here to these Romans is have nothing to do with them and their error. I think Christ is the model of that. When he was tempted by Satan in the wilderness, he didn't debate the devil. He responded to each challenge with Scripture. He never doubted God. He never doubted God's goodness. He never doubted his Father's promises. He interpreted the Bible correctly, and he relied upon it completely. This is Jesus Christ in his humanity showing you and me how we are to deal with the temptations and the challenges of life, with the Word of God. And finally, after the third temptation, he said, "Go, Satan, be gone." Satan was gone because the Son of God told him to depart. But the lesson in all of that is, don't give your time and attention to false teachers and theological error. Train your mind on the Word of God. Know it well. And if you do, if you know it well, if you train your mind on Scripture, you will not be naive. You will not doubt God's goodness and be carried away by heresy and immorality or foolishness. That's Paul's advice in verse 19. He praises the Romans. They were a mature church and well known for their obedience. They were a cause of rejoicing for him. But nevertheless, he said, I want you to be wise in what is good and innocent in what is evil. In other words, you're obedient and your reputation is widespread for your obedience. You're a mature church, but you never reach a point where you don't need to be wiser and be wise in what is good and innocent in what is evil. It's similar to what the Lord told his disciples in Matthew chapter 10 and verse 16. Be shrewd as serpents and innocent as doves. In other words, know and follow wise instruction. And that way, we will be immune to, unaffected by evil influences. Satan offered Eve the knowledge of good and evil by doing evil, which he promised would make her like God. It did the opposite. It made her and Adam like the devil. Paul's counsel was, know good and avoid evil. We don't need to know evil. We are to know the nature of evil and be aware of its presence, know about it, but not all about it. Instead, we are to fill our minds with good. We are to fill our minds with the things of God. We're to know the doctrines of this letter, this great book of Romans. We're to know the doctrines and the truth of the Word of God. That will be a lamp to our feet. That will give us wisdom and make us like Christ so that we won't be carried away by every wind of doctrine. We have a responsibility to do that. We have a responsibility to not be naive. We should not be unsuspecting. So Paul gives three means of defense, three protective measures. First, keep your eye on those who cause division. Second, turn away from them. And third, be wise in what is good. Now, that calls for discipline. That calls for diligence. Discipline and diligence, for example, in being in church, being a regular attender under the Word of God, being a man or woman that studies regularly your Bible, that understands the truth of God. This is serious, and you need to be devoted to it. It is a lamp to our feet. So it's an encouragement to that. It requires discipline and diligence. Fortunately, our protection, though, does not ultimately rest with us. That is God's work. He will do this. He will cause us to prevail. That's the encouragement Paul gives in verse 20, where he prophesies, "The God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet." Satan is the agent of conflict and disorder. Through his ministers, the false teachers, he causes divisions in the church and he draws away people into error. But God will crush him. It seems strange that Paul would describe God as the God of peace, making war by crushing Satan. But it shouldn't seem strange. It is because God is the source of all peace that he must remove all obstacles to peace. And so to make the world whole, he must overthrow our great enemy. And he will. That's the prophecy. And Paul gave it to encourage the Romans in their effort to increase in wisdom, to resist evil, and to overcome false teaching. The Christian's effort will not be in vain. We will triumph. That assurance of victory in the end goes all the way back to the beginning, to the first prophecy that was given in Genesis 3:15. That's what Paul is alluding to here, the prophecy where the Lord told the serpent, really Satan, that he would crush him. Satan would bruise his heel and he would bruise his head. That was the first announcement of the gospel. It's the promise of peace that God will achieve through the cross of Christ. There at Calvary, Satan bruised Christ's heel. He injured him through the mockery, the beatings, the humiliation, the agony of the crucifixion, which all ended in his death. But it was only temporary. It was not a final defeat. The cross was not ultimately fatal. It was not finally fatal. It was like a crushing of Christ's heel from which he recovered because he rose from the dead. The cross was the victory. It's where Christ accomplished atonement. It's where he made the full payment for sin and fully satisfied God's justice toward his elect. Having paid for our sins, he transferred us out of the devil's domain. Satan no longer has authority over us. His power was broken on the cross, and his final judgment sealed. Now, Satan is still active. But as Luther wrote, his doom is sure, and Paul says it will come soon. God will crush him under the feet of the faithful. Soon. Now, he said that 2,000 years ago. So soon means sooner to us. It will happen at the Lord's second coming when Satan is bound, imprisoned, and then afterward thrown into the lake of fire. That is the devil's ultimate destiny. And ours, by God's grace, is to triumph over him and his forces. So in the meantime, we are to fight the good fight and fight that fight with confidence. The Christian life is described as a battle, probably most clearly in Ephesians chapter 6, but it's a battle with weapons and armor and victory. In 2 Corinthians 11, Paul refers to deceitful workers who disguise themselves as apostles of Christ. It's not surprising that they do that because he says even Satan disguises himself as an angel of light. And so his servants, men in the ministry, present themselves as servants of righteousness, as preachers and theologians, as men who have the truth. But we triumph over them in the present by knowing the truth. That's our weapon, the sword of the Word of God, which by means of it, we expose error and make it known. And the false teachers cannot triumph over God's people? Not ultimately. Christ has promised that. He said, "The gates of hell shall not prevail against his church," Matthew 16, verse 18. And history supports that. It's littered with heresies that failed, like that of the ancient Ebionites and Gnosticism and Arianism. They've all been snuffed out or faded away. Protestant liberalism, with some of that theology in it, is dead. Even Richard Niebuhr, no evangelical, famously explained the message of liberalism and the liberal churches as a God without wrath brought men without sin into a kingdom without judgment through the ministrations of Christ without a cross. Well, there's not much there in that message. So for years, modern mainline denominations have experienced a crisis in attendance, empty church buildings across Western Europe and the United States. That's not a message that has life to it. May be appealing in some ways, but it's a dead message and leads to dead congregations. Error is a danger, and false brethren are parasites, but the promise to us is we will win. We will triumph. We who have the truth, who have the gospel of Jesus Christ. So be diligent. Hold to the faith is what Paul is saying. That's the encouragement he's giving. And we will win because the battle ultimately is not ours. It's the Lord's. He will give us the strength, the wisdom, the success. He enables us to triumph now in the present, and finally, when the Lord returns. It is God who will crush Satan under our feet. It's God who does it then. It's God who does it now. He uses us, but it's his power. It's he who does it. So Paul concludes the passage by praying for the grace of God on them and on us. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. That's Paul's third benediction in chapter 15 and verse 13. And then in chapter 15, verse 33, he gave benedictions. And in both, he prayed that the Romans would be filled with hope, with joy, and peace. And here, a third time, Paul prays for grace, one of his favorite subjects. There is no greater subject in the Word of God than that, than the grace of God. It's what we all need. It's what every believer has received. saving grace. He chose us before time. And apart from anything that we did or anything that he foresaw us doing, Christ redeemed us by his death, and the Holy Spirit drew us to himself in faith, drew us to the cross, drew us to Christ, drew us to salvation. It was his irresistible grace that brought us to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ and all that is involved in the Godhead. Now that is special grace, that saving grace. It is God's free gift. You cannot earn it. You can do nothing to achieve it. It's all of God. And there is preserving grace, sanctifying grace, the grace of God that produces perseverance in his saints, that changes us and gives us spiritual growth. That's what Paul is speaking of here. We need that constantly. No victories, present or future, are possible apart from God's free and sovereign grace. And God promises to provide us with it. His elect will persevere because the Holy Spirit dwells within us to give us the life of Christ constantly, to give us faith constantly. That faith may grow weak at times. We may drift at times, but the Spirit of God is there and will never let us drift away. He will bring us back. Christ will never disown us. He is constantly with us. His elect persevere to the end. We are secure forever. We sang about that in our second hymn this morning. Augustus Toplady, one of the great Calvinists and great hymn writers of the church, made that very clear. Paul makes that very clear in numerous places, but he makes it clear in Philippians, when he told the Philippians in chapter 1, verse 6, "He who began a good work in you will perfect it until the day of Christ Jesus." He will always supply us with the grace we need and never let us go. He will complete the work that he began. And Paul prays that here, that God would do what he promises to do, supply the Romans with grace. And he did, just as he will do for us. So we're to look to him for the strength and the victory. We're encouraged to be diligent, to be alert, to be watchful, to keep our eye on things. But ultimately, we will do that successfully because of the grace of God within us. He gives the strength and victory. But this is not only a prayer for Christ's help. It's an act of worship as well. It's a recognition of Christ's deity. Grace is from God. It's a divine gift. And Paul prays for the grace of our Lord Jesus. Grace comes from him. It's because Jesus is Lord, because he is God, that we have confidence in him and our victory over the devil is certain. Luther stated that in his hymn, "Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. We're not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing." Who is that man? Luther asked. He's more than a man. Lord Sabaoth, his name from age to age the same, and he must win the battle. Must win, and he will win. "However much the church may be distracted and troubled," Charles Hodge wrote, "error and its advocates cannot finally prevail. God will ultimately bruise him under the feet of his people." We are, as Paul said earlier in chapter 8, more than conquerors through him who loved us. What an encouragement that is. That's what you are as a believer in Jesus Christ. You are a conqueror. You're more than a conqueror. He will complete the work that he began in us, give us victory over sin and Satan, and finally glorify us. That is the assurance that every believer in Jesus Christ has. Is that your assurance? Do you know Christ the Lord, who is very God, a very God, and perfect man? The apostle, The Apostle John wrote that the whole world lies in the evil one. Paul says the evil one, Satan, will be crushed soon. So where are you? Are you in the evil one? That's a dangerous place to be. Sooner or later, the end will come. It comes for all of us. It must. But there's forgiveness and there's life in Christ. Flee to Him if you've not done that. Recognize your need of the Savior and trust in Jesus Christ. He receives all who do. May God help you to do that. May help you to look to Him continually. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for the instruction that the apostle gave us. We thank You for the warning that he set before us. We thank You for the encouragement we have that we will soon crush Satan under our feet by the power of God. We'll do it because He'll do it through us. But that's the victory that's before us. We will triumph. That's Your grace, Your sovereign grace. We thank You for it. We thank You for the grace that is able to quicken the dead, that's able to bring life, spiritual life, to those that are not only dead in regard to their connection to You, but in rebellion against You. And You change us completely and make us Your children and heirs for all eternity. We thank You for that grace. May we live for You. May we be faithful to You. We pray these things in Christ's name.